Welcome to Grace Community Church. Glad you could be here this morning. We're going to start off right off the bat, bring Jeff Shrum up here. Jeff, come on up. The reason why is he's got to be at Faith Missionary Church in their worship service in about 25 minutes. So 10-minute drive down there, so we need to get moving here. I want to introduce to you Jeff Shrum. Carl, I'm going to take this mic off, okay? Jeff is about to leave us, and I wanted you to meet him. For those of you who have never met him, get to know him a little bit and the ministry that God's called him to, and I'm going to ask him briefly, just tell us, what has God called you to?
Okay, I think God is leading me to work with Wycliffe Bible Translators as a translator. I was accepted in the fall, and I've been working on paying off student loans and building up my partnership. Preparing to go, and I think it's time, and I'm going to go to Dallas and start my training at the end of August.
Now, when you go to do your training, where are you going to do that?
Well, it's in Dallas, the Dallas area, and Wycliffe and the Summer Institute of Linguistics has a center there. Some of the courses are there, and some are at the University of Texas, and so I'll be registered both places and taking courses both places.
I heard some of the courses yesterday that you're going to be taking. Tell them some of the courses you're going to be taking. These things that we all need to be taking. Listen.
Phonetics, phonology, grammatical analysis, literacy in third culture, cross-cultural anthropology, translation principles, things like that.
Yeah, who wants to sign up? Let's sign up next week. Now, I can't even pronounce some of those things. Well, that's the whole idea, right?
That's right.
That's right. Okay. I'm sorry, that was bad, wasn't it? So I want you to meet him and to know what's going on in his life. This is going to be a long haul for you, right? About how long training is it going to take, and then actually until you actually hit the field, so to speak?
Yeah, the training is 4 semesters. I need to start soon because I keep adding semesters. And then there'll be language school. I hope to go to French West Africa. That's the area that I feel burdened for. So I have to learn French first. And then, of course, there's support raising. It can be 3 or 4 years before I actually set foot in Africa.
So we need to get behind him now. This has been already a long haul, and then the decision to go this week was a decision that was not made too lightly. He felt, and I agree with him, needs to get going on this and get the training going so that he can get to the field. Becoming a Bible translator is not an easy task at all. It takes a lot of education. Now, you are right now currently accepted by Wycliffe, and you are a missionary of Wycliffe. Is that correct?
Yes.
Right now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So just so you know this, he is on support right now. In other words, he's trying to raise his support right now. He's not going to get his education and then raise his support and then go. He is raising his support right now, and you need to know of the money that he needs right now, although it's minimal compared to what it's going to be when he goes to Africa. He's still trying to raise support, and at this time, how much percent in?
It's about 15%.
15%. So he's got a long way to go, and I want to encourage you to consider how you might be able to support Jeff in his ministry. We're excited about it, and we know we'll see you on vacations, right, and on summer and things like that for the next couple of years, and you can keep us up to speed with what's going on. But I wonder if we could have a word of prayer, and then you can head off to Faith.
Hey, that'd be great.
Tell them about it. Let's pray. Father, I ask that you go with Jeff in the days ahead, and I pray that you'll calm his heart and give him a peace that he's making the right decision to head to Texas. And I pray in the process of taking all these very difficult courses that you'll give him great wisdom and prepare him quickly for the ministry of Bible translation in West Africa. And we thank you for him, and I pray for us as Grace Community Church, as his sending body, that we'll consider how each one of us might be able to support Jeff in the days ahead. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, Jeff. Appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you.
Great. All right, let's sing.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
All right, let's do that one again.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. Gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. Again, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my...
We gotta do that one more time. Let's stand.
I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, God of my salvation be exalted. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
I'd say amen to that. I don't know about you. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live.
I praise you because I am fearfully made and wonderful made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well.
Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture.
Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise him.
It is good to praise the Lord and to make music to your name, O Most High, to proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night.
Praise be to the Lord forever. Amen and amen.
Talk about having everybody in the room at one time. As you can see, we're even bringing in the kids. In a minute, the babies and infants, the infants and crawlers will be in here too. So we got everybody in here at one time. Let's come down the middle aisle. You want to help? Why don't you come? What? Come on, kids, you can come up here and sit on the stage for a second, okay? There are times you just go with the flow, you know? This is one of those times. Is that it? If you ever wonder what happens in the rest of the building while you're in here worshiping, you're going to get an idea right now. This is our teach. We're going to take a moment to celebrate our ministry. I will speak as loudly as I can. A time to show some appreciation to our teachers. And as soon as we're all seated and kids, you're going to get to watch a really neat video. All right? You're all going to have to direct your attention to this screen over here. Now, teachers and kids, we need to tell you, we're going to turn the lights off, so we don't want you to be surprised. Okay, Carl.
As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord.
That video was done by Mike Chandler, who every Sunday is running our video back here. He produced that, did an excellent job. All right, now kids, I need to ask a favor of all of you, and that is you all sit down quietly just for a couple of minutes here, because the people that we want to call attention to just for a couple of minutes are the people that have taken all the time to teach you over the past years, okay? We're going to start from the oldest and work to the youngest teachers. I would ask you not to applaud. The whole idea is to honor God as He has used the gifts of these folks in the lives of these children that you see right here. First of all, I want you to, if you have never met them, I want you to see Connie Lander and Leslie Heath. They have been our childhood and early childhood directors here. Why don't you stand up, Connie? Where's Leslie? Right here, okay? They're going to hand out some teacher certificates. If we call your name, would you please come and get it, maybe to the head of the aisle? And we'd like to let you know how much we appreciate you. This will take a moment, so hang in there, folks. Third and fourth grade department leader. The certificates? The certificates? We don't have the certificates. I'm sorry? We will give them later. They're probably sitting on the desk in the office.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. Here. This is what you call winging it, folks. That'll get you in the office. Let me call these names off, and then we'll get your certificates to you as soon as she gets them here. All right. Fifth grade department leader, Mark Coy. Helping Mark with teaching was Bill Duke. If you would just stand, at least we can see where you are, and come up here. Bill Duke, Tim Hassinger, and Cindy Palmer, helping with fifth grade. Cindy Parkman is the department leader for third and fourth grade, along with Lisa Sheeman and Gloria Barber. Helping them are Terry Heath, Matt Miller, Jerry Svensson, Yoshiko Estes, Cindy Parkman, I already called her, Mark Sinnock, Catherine Sinnock, Bill Driehorst, Jan Young, John Barber, Tim Bannister, Betsy Fladung, Merle Sinclair, and Frank Sinclair. Our first and second grade department leader was Leslie Heath. Helping Leslie are Pam Tomasic, John Davies, Jenny Gunn, Sherry Green, David Palmer, Lyndall Traeger, Stan Traeger, Bob Kopniski, Ginny Kopniski, Mary Savage, David Savage, Phil Ladner, Bobby Erb, Jennifer Ayers, Susie Mushberger, Sam Ryan, Denise Swanson, Scott Swanson, Ann Helmer, David Helmer, Susan Robertson, and Chris Wilson. Big class. Our kindergarten teachers, led by department leader Julie Schilling, Peggy Driehorst, Lynn Schilling, Polly Duke, Tony Hinkle, Tim Reimenschnitter, Patty Fromke, Susan Mowry, Jan Summer, and Heather Gutwein. The department leader for our four and fives was Elaine Brown. Helping Elaine were Rick Brown, Kent Carmer, Lori Shedler, Paul Thompson, Valerie Stombaugh, Patty Perkins, Ruth Terpstra, John Holmes, Dick Price, Mike Chandler, Jerry Shedler, John Bakey, Carrie Moore, and Brian Peters. Our three and fours teacher, department leader Charlene Blaschke, helping her, Becky Gerdemuller, Carl Gerdemuller, Dean Amstutz, Valerie Lalka, Steve Lalka, Jana Weir, Janelle Alt, Mark Vollmer, Linda Amstutz, Sue Price, Bev Reynolds, Bob Blaschke, Liz Hansen, Jim Gunn, and Ruth Van Rieken. Our department leader for our twos and threes was Kim Sanborn, with Vicki Andretti, Alice Langford, Jim Cummer, Linda Gates, Greg and Cindy Dubay, Kathy Wilson, Lisa Hetty, Tom Hetty, Keith Sanborn, David Robertson, Don Moore, Carrie Cleverly, Sherry Miller, Bill Frick, Kim Law, Linda Hinkle, Sandy Nussbaum, Sarah Carmer, Chris LeBlond, Deborah Langford, and Bill Frege. Toddler 2 workers with Tanya Hassinger as department leader, Linda Tremblay, Mike and Stacy Morgan, Susan Allenson, Susie Scott, Amy Morrison, Lynn Sproul, Kathy McQuiston, Mary Ish, Anita Hopper, and Annie Bennett. Toddler 1 workers with Cindy McElerney, department leader, Bob and Diane Horn, Linda Bannister, Vicki Coy, Pam Olson, Tom and Jean Weir, Martha Dooley, Leanne Bakey, Gay and Kirk Hill, Laura and Tom Green, Pam Ryan, Kathy Thomas, Diane Reimenschnitter, Sherry McGovern, and Gail Booker. Helping with our infants and crawlers, our last department, Marilyn Erb, department leader, Ann Helmer, Barry and Ina Brown, Josie Tillew, Sherry Holmes, Ralph and Janie Gwaltney, Jennifer Peters, Linda Hall, Susan Allgood, Sandy Frege, Penny Rodriguez, Sue Berger, Mary Costin, Kim Davis, Ben and Fran Ito, Judy Dubaugh, Lynn Keenan, and Jan Greiner. And I want you to understand something about all these folks, and you hear all this noise. They are teaching your children, and they are also a support to the worship service, especially for the younger ones, and they're making it possible for us to worship. We want to praise God right now and thank Him for using the gifts of these people. Would you applaud and praise God for what these people are doing? And to show you teachers, they have learned something. They're going to sing something for you. They don't even know. Kids, we're going to sing the B-I-B-L-E for them, okay? All right, let's sing.
The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E.
Join us, sing. All right, well, I forgot they did that. All right, they do it again. Now I have to say Bible at the end, just with them. Everybody sing together.
The B-I-B-L-E.
It's a good one.
All right, kids, you can go back to your classes. Teachers, you can lead them out.
On the journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us line the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly love. Behind us, find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. After all our hopes and dreams have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind, may the clues that they discover, the memories they uncover, to the road we each must find. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful.
Can you stand with me for a word of prayer? Father, right now I'm overwhelmed with the responsibility that I have as a father to be faithful to you, so that the footsteps that my children are following will be ones that will lead them to you. And the children that we're responsible for here at Grace Community Church, I I feel the same responsibility for all of them. And I pray that you'll help us to continue to be faithful to you so that we might share the wealth of the treasures that you've put in the storeroom of our hearts with them. We'll be faithful to you so that our neighbors will see you and our friends and our family. And I agree with the writer of that song. It's my desire that all who come behind us will find us faithful. And I pray that you will speak to us mightily through your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to call your attention to a couple items for your prayers. Number one, some of you know Rose Funkhauser, a member of Faith Missionary Church. Just want to let you know that her mother died this past week, and if you would pray for her, she would appreciate it. And if you're interested in the funeral, we'll be at the Leopard Hurt Funeral Home Monday at 1 o'clock. So pray for Rose Funkhauser. Continue to pray for Amy Pfaffenberger. We told you about her last week. There is no change at this point. She is still unconscious, and they're just kind of hanging on to see what's going to happen, what God's going to do, but very, very difficult decisions in the days ahead. Very difficult, the most difficult of life for their family. They're going to have to deal with, so pray for them. As an item of praise, he probably would not appreciate me doing this and calling attention to him, but I want to thank God. We have prayed for John Batchelder and the surgery that he had on his back, and John's with us this morning as a tribute to God's graciousness. Praise God. This morning I'm going to break a cardinal rule of preaching. I'm going to preach at one family in this church. Bob, Mary, and Mary Jean Sparkstrom and their children, Tony and Sally. Bob and Mary Jean, when I read the parable that we're going to look at this morning, I thought of you. Now, you've been attending Grace for some time. And before Grace, you attended a lot of other churches for years. You've attended community Bible studies and small group Bible studies. You've listened to Christian radio, TV. You've served, Bob, I know you've served on several boards, Christian boards. And Mary Jean, you've been involved in many groups of that kind. And kids, Tony is a teenager and Sally an elementary school age child. You've heard a lot of Bible stories over and over and over. You've been to camps and you've been to youth conferences every summer. Frankly, Bob, Mary Jean, Tony, and Sally, maybe you've been Christians a little too long. Like I said, when I read this parable this morning, I thought of you. And Bob and Mary Jean, and Tony and Sally, I hope you listen very carefully this morning to what God has to say through this parable to you. In Matthew chapter 13, verses 51 and 52. This parable we're going to look at this morning is the last parable that we're going to look at this summer. In June, we began a series called Living Between the Already and the Not Yet. The kingdom of heaven come to earth. It is already here. Jesus instituted or brought into this world the kingdom of heaven. But it's not yet here in all its fulfillment. Jesus is not reigning on earth now as he will. So We're living between the already and the not yet. And I believe he used the parables that we've looked at and many others to describe the kingdom of heaven, what it's all about. That's what we've been looking at this summer. We looked at a bunch of them. I've enjoyed it, to tell you the truth, the study. This specific parable in Matthew chapter 13, verse 52, is kind of an obscure one. It's one that not a whole lot of comments on, but I found it fascinating. And it's the last in a series of parables that we find in Matthew chapter 13. We've looked at just about all the parables of Matthew chapter 13 at some time this summer. Well, this is the last of those parables. If you remember, the beginning of Matthew chapter 13, the parable of the sower, the parable of the weeds, the parable of the mustard seed and the yeast were all said to the crowds. And then Jesus and his disciples retired to a home where he told them the parable of the hidden treasure and the pearl, the parable of the net, which we haven't looked at, and then he wraps it up with this parable. It is a wrap-up, and I think it is meant to tie together what he has said in the other parables in Matthew chapter 13. Let's look at verse 51. See what he says to get into the parable. It's actually a question, verse 51. He's talking to his disciples. He says, "Have you understood all these things?" Now, these things, no doubt, refer to everything he has said previously, the other parables. Have you understood? Excuse me. "Have you understood these things?" And they reply, "Yes." Now, what's really funny about it is we know that they really didn't understand it at all. I mean, they understood some of it, but they didn't understand all of it. We knew that later, as we see what happens as it comes to the end of Jesus' life. They were confused. I don't think they really had a full grasp. And it took them a while until the Holy Spirit came and indwelt them till they really started to understand what this kingdom of heaven on earth is all about. At any rate, they say yes. Now, Bob, Mary Jean, Tony, Sally, the same question is directed at you. Have you understood all these things? Have you understood all that you've been taught in Sunday school for all these years? Have you gotten a grasp of all the comments that you've heard through sermons and through Charles Stanley on television and things like that? Do you understand? You don't have to understand all of it, but don't you, Bob, really have a pretty good grasp of what you've been taught? Probably you'd say yes, wouldn't you? I would. I mean, I've been in church. I've been a church rat ever since I was born and taken into church, so I think I understand, all right? That same question is directed at you, Bob, Mary Jean, and Tony, and Sally. Now let's look at verse 52. And look at the reply Jesus makes. After the say, "Have you understood all things?" Jesus asked, "Yes," they replied. 52, he says to them, Therefore, or okay, since you understand, or taking your word for it that you understand, now let me tell you something else. Therefore, every teacher of the law who has been instructed about the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. Therefore, since you understand, I think Jesus is offering them a couple of challenges here. Since you understand, first of all, you now have a new role to play. Since you understand all these things, you have a new role to play. We're going to look at that role in a minute. And since you now understand all these things, you now have a new responsibility to fulfill. You have a new role to play and a new responsibility to fulfill. Bob, Mary Jean, Tony, and Sally, the challenge is the same for you as it was for the disciples. Since you understand, since you have been taught all these things for all these years, you now have a new role, you have a new responsibility. Let's look closer at 52 and take a look at those two challenges. First challenge, since you understand, you now have a new role to play. What was that role? the role was, you are now a teacher of the law. Therefore, every teacher of the law who has been instructed about the kingdom. Now, in the King James Version, the word is scribe. Scribe. Now, it's very odd. I found it odd that Jesus would refer to his disciples as scribes. I found it odd because throughout the rest of the Gospels, you don't find Jesus being very complimentary to scribes. I picked two verses out. Look what he says in Luke 11:52 to the teachers of the law, the scribes. Woe to you, experts in the law, because you have taken away the key to knowledge. You yourselves have not entered, and you have hindered those who are entering. Hey, scribes, teachers of the law, you're no good. Not only are you not entering into the knowledge of God, but you're keeping others from it. Matthew 23:27. Woe to you, teachers of the law, scribes, and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of dead man's bones and everything unclean. Not real complimentary to teachers of the law and scribes. What was a scribe? Scribe was literally a person who wrote, or a person who recorded the law. Now, in addition to that, the scribe took on another responsibility when it was instituted, and that was to interpret what they wrote. So a scribe was a person who wrote the law, recorded it, and then helped others to understand what it meant. Sort of like a preacher today, helping people to understand, or a teacher understanding the Word of God. Now, in Jesus' day, the scribes had become something that they were never instituted to be. They became a party with their own traditions. You see, their interpretations of the law gradually became legalistic traditions and rules of conduct. And they bore no resemblance at all, or little resemblance at all, to the law that they were taken from. And with this interpretation, and with the people really not knowing the law themselves and having to have scribes, this party of scribes and teachers of law derived a whole lot of power and prestige. They were very important people in that society, and they had a lot of power, and they held people in check. That's why Jesus said, you have hindered those who were entering into the knowledge that they could have of God. They had a lot of power. Now, that's not the way the scribes were supposed to be originally. They were originally priests and Levites with the whole idea in mind to help people understand the truth of the law. A very famous scribe from the Old Testament was Ezra. If you remember who Ezra was, he was a priest, a teacher of the law, who returned with the remnant back to the land of Israel after having been in captivity in Babylon. He was one that came back with the first couple of waves. Listen what is said about him in Ezra 7:6. This Ezra came up from Babylon. He was a teacher, well-versed in the law of Moses, which the Lord, the God of Israel, had given. And in Ezra 7:10, for Ezra had devoted himself to the study and observance of the law of the Lord and to teaching its decrees and laws in Israel. Now he returned to the land with Nehemiah. Nehemiah built the walls, and then listen to what Ezra did in Nehemiah 8:2 and 3. This is after the walls are rebuilt in Israel. And listen to what it says about him. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women, all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men and women and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. You see, he was doing what a scribe needed to do, and that was get out the book of the law, and which was the Pentateuch at that time, and explain it to the people. Now, for those of you who know the book of Nehemiah, you know what happened. As he read the law, they just burst into tears. They were so moved by what they hadn't heard it in years. And as he read it to them, and my guess as a scribe, he helped interpret it, maybe do a little preaching. Can you imagine that? Having all those people, thousands of people, having that opportunity. But he explained the law to them. Now, that's what Jesus was talking about when he said or referred to the fact, implied, that his disciples, and you, Bob, and Mary Jean, and Tony, and Sally, this, you are to be teachers of the law, scribes, those who would help others understand the meaning of God's word. Now, that was the role they were supposed to fill, and that's the role you and I are supposed to fill. We are supposed to be scribes, to bring out the word of God and help others understand it. Now, Jesus adds another dimension to that role. Let's go on. Therefore, every teacher of the law who has been instructed about the kingdom of heaven. Another dimension to this role of scribe is this is not just any scribe, but a scribe that's been instructed about the kingdom. Now, the word instructed means to be discipled. That's the word for discipled. They were discipled about the kingdom. A way you actually could say it, rather than discipled about the kingdom, they have become disciples of the kingdom. And their education, disciples' education, was not at the typical rabbinical schools, but their education was at the college of the feet. They went to the college of the feet. Luke 10:39, we find Mary learning and sitting at the foot of Jesus. That's what these disciples, that's how they learned. That's how they were trained in God's word and in the truth of the kingdom. They sat at Jesus' feet. Now, like his followers, you and I, you, Bob, and Mary Jean, and Tony, and Sally, and I, have been discipled in the truths of the kingdom. Bob, let me ask you something. How many times have you heard the parable of the sower? A zillion, maybe? How many times? What? 3 or 4 sermons, 5 or 6 Sunday school classes, 2 or 3 TV evangelists. You've heard the parable of the sower over and over and over again. You could preach it yourself. Hey, Tony and Sally, you know, when you're little kids, how many times did you see that parable of the sower where the man casts seed onto the ground and some of it falls on the hard ground, and some of it falls on the rocky ground, and some of it falls on the weedy ground, some of it falls on the good ground. You've seen the flannel graph with the little guy with the pouch, right, and throwing the seed. You know that story. How many times have you been instructed about the kingdom of heaven? The disciples sat at Jesus' feet. Now, we haven't had to have that opportunity. We haven't had that opportunity, but I'll tell you what we do have. According to Paul in 1 Corinthians, we have the mind of Christ. We have been instructed in the kingdom. We are like teachers of the law who have been discipled in the kingdom of heaven. Have you understood all these things? Yes. If you have understood, then you have a new role. And if you have that new role, you also have a new responsibility. Let's take a look at the responsibility. Since you understand, you have a new responsibility to fulfill. Let me read 52 again. Therefore, every teacher of the law who's been instructed about the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. What is the responsibility that you have, Mary Jean? What's the responsibility you have, Sally, and Tony, and Bob? The responsibility you have is to act like a wealthy homeowner. To act like a wealthy homeowner. Now, this homeowner appears every now and then in Jesus' teaching. Frequently shows up. Sometimes the homeowner is a reference to God, sometimes to Jesus, and sometimes to the disciples. In this case, it's a reference to his disciples. You see, Jesus' disciples, and you and I, Bob, are like wealthy homeowners who have great treasures in our storeroom. We have great treasures in our storeroom. And what is our storeroom? Matthew 6:21. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Our storeroom is our heart, Matthew 6:21. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 12:35, the good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him, and the evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. Look at the treasures that have been stored away in your heart. Treasures about prayer that you've learned. Treasures about heaven. Treasures about salvation. In your storeroom, in my storeroom, in the storeroom of the disciples' hearts, were wonderful treasures that were placed there by Jesus. And the responsibility we have as scribes, teachers of the law, who have been instructed and have had these treasures placed in our hearts, our responsibility is what? To bring them out. To bring them out of our storeroom. Not just to look at, wow, look at this. Look at this truth I learned about prayer. Wonderful. Hey, Jim, look at this truth I learned about prayer. Did you have a truth like this? Why don't you pull one out too? Yeah. Wow, Don, look at this here. Look at these truths about prayer. Great treasures. Frank, you got any truths about prayer? Whoa, look, you've got a few too. Whoa, this is great. We had to get a bunch of wealthy homeowners together and talk about all the wonderful treasures inside. Isn't that what we do on Sunday mornings, Sunday school classes? Yeah. Yeah, teacher, I've got a treasure here too. How many have treasures about prayer in your heart? Hey, Bob, Mary Jean, let me see a couple of them treasures. Okay, yeah. Is that why we're supposed to bring them out? So that we can admire them or share them with other wealthy homeowners? I think they're to be brought out for another reason. Because there are people out there who have never seen a treasure about prayer. If they were to see the beauty of that treasure, or the beauty of the wonderful treasure of God's sovereignty, if they were to see that, they would gasp with delight. That's why we're to bring it out. For others' benefits who have never experienced those treasures. Jesus said it in other ways. Matthew 10:27. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. He said it another way. Matthew 18:19-20. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. Bring out your treasures. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Bring out your treasures. Hey, Bob. Hey, Mary Jean. Hey, Tony. Hey, Sally. How about sharing the wealth? Share the wealth. Bring it out. People desperately need to see the treasures that you have in your heart. Old and new says that this owner brought out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. Now, what did the disciples understand that to mean? Well, it could be several things. Could mean that it was their understanding of the law, which was the old, and their understanding of the new covenant in Jesus Christ, which is the new. Or it could mean their understanding of the kingdom, the old understanding of the kingdom, and their understanding, the new understanding of the kingdom that Jesus was teaching them. Both were important. Both were treasures they were to bring out of their hearts. So it means for us, old and new. I believe it means the whole truth of God that we've been taught. all those treasures you've accumulated from Sunday school classes and sermons and Bible studies, from your dad to your youth leader, from Mrs. Stump, your third grade teacher, to Charles Stanley, the TV preacher. All those wonderful treasures that you've accumulated, bring them out. Bring out the old and the new, like a wealthy homeowner. Just for a second, just to spark your memory a little bit, let's just look at a few quickly samples of the new treasures that perhaps you've picked up, I've picked up this summer. The treasure of the parable of the prodigal son. God on the road, looking for the lost one. What a treasure to bring out. Hey, there are people that are living around us that would love to hear about God the Father on the road looking for lost people. That's a treasure that needs to be brought out. The parable of the sower we've referred to. Hearts must be right. There are people with hard hearts out there that need to know that they need to have their hearts tilled up. Need to see that the reason why the truths of God are not going in is because they've got weeds and they've got rocks or the ground is hard packed. What a treasure to pull out. The parable of the narrow and the wide gates. Look, you have friends, Bob, that you're around all the time that need to know that there's a choice you need to make in life between the narrow gate and the wide gate. What a treasure. The parable of the unmerciful servant. A parable of forgiveness. The parable of brokenness. How many people do you know that are not able to forgive? They're living bound up in the inability to forgive. Pull out that treasure. Help them to see that treasure. And the parable of the pearl. How many people do you know that see they have no sense of self-worth whatsoever? Bring out the pearl. Bring out that treasure. Show them that Jesus cared for them enough to give His life, and they are priceless to Him. New treasures. New treasures that have been put into the storeroom of your heart. Bob, your boss needs to see these treasures. Your secretary. Bob, you know those kids that were sitting up here today? All these little kids? They need to see the treasures that God has put in your heart. Hey, for years you've been taught. Why are you hoarding it all yourself, Bob? Mary Jean, why are you sitting on these treasures? You know, there are little kids up here that would just love to hear you pull a couple treasures out of your heart, out of the storeroom, and for you to share it with them. Hey, look at this. Wow. Mary Jean, your neighbor, your mom, the people down at Wheeler Mission are looking for treasures. Tony, the kid in the band that you play beside, or that kid on the soccer team, they want to see some of the treasures. They've never seen these things before. And Sally, your friend down the street, and your cousin, all of them want to see your treasures. They have empty storerooms that they keep filling with other things that aren't satisfying them. Share the wealth. Stand with me. Father, as we go from this place, help us to be faithful to pull the treasures out that you have stored up in our hearts. Help us to be teachers of the law, helping people to understand the truths of the word as disciples of the kingdom, to be like that wealthy homeowner, to pull them out and share those treasures with people who have never experienced the wonders of your truths. And we thank you. You're going to help us to be faithful in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning.